heaven because you were forsaken and I'm accepted. Let's worship God this evening, church. Seth, would you open us up in prayer? you take some time, you greet one another this evening. Once again, we want to welcome you to the Door Church. Glad that you are here this Wednesday evening. Just real quick, we do want to bring a few things to, again, to remembrance of what's happening in our schedule for the month of February. And just real quick, we have the marriage retreat this weekend, Friday and Saturday, there in McMinnville. If you need the information, you can take a picture of the screen. Or you can let me know, and I can provide you the details. And again, the Couples Fellowship on the 23rd, and that's going to be at 6 o'clock at our house. And then the Weekend Ministry, of course, Sunday morning, 11 o'clock, and our evening service at 6 for you to come and be able to prepare in prayer at 5, an hour before the service, and encourage you to be a part of that. Take some flyers with you, invite somebody out, and see what God's going to do in their hearts and in their lives. And so, again, calendars on the back table. Please grab one on your way out. And we're going to go ahead and take up our offering this evening. As our usher comes forward, we're going to continue to give. We're going to continue to make our investments in the things of God. And I was driving this morning after I dropped off my wife and my daughter at work. I went around and looked at some of the buildings that I have kind of kept my eye on. And, you know, just the thought of, you know, we need to eventually get out of this building, right? I don't know about you, but I want heating and cooling in my building. And, but, you know, it would require for us to pay an increase in rent and at least $2,000 more in rent, which I don't know if we can handle right now, but believing God for great things, believing God for miracles, you know. So I'm just looking ahead, having a vision and saying, God, you are able to bless your people. God, you are able to bring forth increase. You are able to give raises. You are able to give extra to your people. You're able to put blessing into their hand so that we can be good stewards of it. And I really believe that, you know, in time, in God's timing, we can eventually get out of here into a different location. Again, this place has been good to us in the way that it has. A lot of little issues probably that go unseen, but it's a lot of hassle trying to deal with them. And this is all in the background. But I do appreciate the faithfulness of the saints in giving and tithing and offerings and pledges. But if we can just think ahead, right, into what God really wants to do and the growth that he wants to bring and the health that he wants to bring in the growth, we can be a part of something that makes impact in our city. And so I really want to encourage you, continue to give your tithes, your offerings, be faithful, believe God, trust God, and see what he will do. Amen. Different ways to give, they're on the screen. Let's bow our heads. Let's close our eyes. Stephen, pray for the offering.
Like you came in Jesus' name.
appreciate that this evening. Let's go ahead and turn our Bibles to the book of Matthew, chapter 5. Book of Matthew, chapter 5. For the next several Wednesdays, I don't know how many Wednesdays, but several Wednesdays, I want to attempt to start another series to be able to cover some of the questions that Jesus asked throughout his 3 years here on earth as he was establishing the church and he was discipling the men and he was teaching the men throughout his time alive and establishing the work. It is said that he asked about 305 questions that are at least written in the Gospels. And I'm not going to be going through all of those questions, but I kind of just I chose a few questions that we can look at and we can dig in a little bit more. But how many know that asking a question is a good thing, right? To inquire, whether it's inquiring of someone else or asking yourself a question, to be able to get some clarity as to what you're reading, to have some understanding of what it is that you read. Even as you're reading the Bible, ask yourself questions about who it's talking about and who it's talking to, or what is it addressing, and just ask yourself questions. Right? When my kids, when they were little, they asked a lot of questions. My son was the question man. I used to love driving with him because he would just talk and talk and talk and ask and ask and ask. But especially when I was trying to put them to bed, that's when the real questions came up. All day, they probably went without asking any questions, but somehow, for some reason, it's time for bed, and I'm laying there with them, trying to get them to pray and go to sleep, and they begin to ask questions, right? They're asking questions about creation, asking questions about life, asking questions about the things they do and people do and this and that, and they're just inquiring. I don't know if it was because they wanted to learn or because they didn't want to go to sleep, but they were curious, right? They wanted to know all these things. And so asking questions allows you to grow, and allows you to grow in wisdom, allows you to grow in understanding. But questions can also reveal the truth about us, right? You meet someone, they begin to ask you questions, and they begin to inquire about your life. They begin to inquire about your past. They begin to inquire about who you are and your family, your friends, and where you come from and what your upbringing was. When we drove down to Modesto, I was able to ask a lot of questions, and Seth was able to ask a lot of questions, and we were bouncing off questions off of each other, my daughter, and we were able to, you know, learn. He learned that we're goofballs, right? And you just begin to just inquire. You begin to know their past. You know their history. And it just brings you to a place where you're understanding each other. But it also brings out the reality of who you are. And I was able to share some of my past, and he was able to share some of his past. And we're able to see the real person. Things that you normally don't talk about in an open setting. But people won't know you until they ask about you, right? You won't know people until you ask about them. And this is how you establish relationships with people. You ask about them and them about you. And so here in our text, we are going to read that Jesus is delivering his sermon on the Mount. He has surrounded himself by people. He has surrounded himself with a lot of personnel. They're inquiring about Jesus, and they're inquiring about his ministry. They're inquiring about
what he does, and they're inquiring about his ministry and his disciples. And, you know, I can almost imagine the conversation that was going on in that time. But here now, he's on this mountain, and he's on this hill, and he's talking to these people. He's preaching to these people. They want to hear what he has to say, but he wants them to consider something important about following him. Jesus was not like the religious leaders, right? He was different. It was very evident, and some of the disciples or some of the people even said, you don't speak like them, you don't teach like them, right? You don't have the authority like them, or they don't have the authority like you. You're different. And so Jesus came to be the change that the world needed. He came, and he went against the grain, right? He went against the flow of everything else. He came to seek and save the lost, and he came to set the captive free. But most importantly, we know that he came and died for our sins, right? So this means that those who follow him had to be different. If he came and died for our sins, it's because he didn't want us to live in sin. So therefore, when he dies and we come to him, he expects for us to change, right? There is an expectation to be transformed. There is an expectation to live a different life. And so Jesus asked a question that would divide genuine believers from the religious believers. And so let's look at this text in Matthew chapter 5 and verse 43. And we're going to read through verse 48. And the Bible says, "You have heard that it was said, 'You shall love your neighbor and hate your enemy.' But I say to you, love your enemies, bless those who curse you, do good to those who hate you, and pray for those who spitefully use you and persecute you, that you may be sons of your Father in heaven, for he makes his sun rise on the evil and on the good, and sends rain on the just and on the unjust. For if you love those who love you, what reward have you? Do not even tax collectors do the same? And if you greet your brethren only, what do you do more than others? Do not even the tax collectors do so? Therefore, you shall be perfect, just as your Father in heaven is perfect." I want to preach a sermon entitled "Doing More Than Others." Consider with me you versus them. So the distinguishing question here in our text that Jesus asked was, what do you do more than others? Now, this is another way of saying, what sets you apart from them? Right? Jesus is inquiring, and he's putting this question, and he's making it personal. He's speaking to those that are hearing him, and he wants to know, what are you doing different that they're not doing? Or what are you doing that they're not doing? Or what are you not doing that they're doing? What sets you apart? What makes you different? Or what extraordinary thing did you do by doing what everyone else does? See, according to this question, it's evident that Jesus, again, expects his followers to be different from those around them. He didn't want them to be like the crowd. He didn't want them to continue to walk like everybody else did. He wanted them to be different. 1 John chapter 2, verse 3 and 6, or through 6, the Bible says, "Now by this we know that we know him. Now by this we know that we know him if we keep his commandments. He who says, 'I know him,' and does not keep his commandments, is a liar, and the truth is not in him. But whoever keeps his word, truly the love of God is perfected in him. By this we know that we are in him." Verse 6 says, "He who says he abides in him ought himself also walk just as he walked." There's a difference. There's a change. There's a transformation that takes place. If you are considering, or if you are saying that you are a follower of Christ, or if you know him, then there has to be a different way that you live. And we know that the world is being deceived, right? There's a lot of lies. This means that we as believers, we shouldn't walk in that deception. There is a way that seems right unto men, but in the end, the Bible says, leads to destruction. They are being deceived, and we should not walk in that way that might seem right, but at the end leads to destruction. We shouldn't be going down that path. We shouldn't be taking that journey. We should not have the same appetites as the world, right? We should not think like the world. We should not be living in a way, or we should be living in a way that is opposite to what the world is doing. So in order to examine our lives, our hearts, and our minds, let's ask ourselves a very important question. And that question is, since the day that you accepted Christ as your Lord and Savior, that since the day that you got saved, since the day that you repented of your sins, since the day that you surrendered your life to Jesus, what difference has that decision made in you? How have you become different? What has changed? What has been transformed? What have you let go? What has changed since then? Some of you may be saved few months, few years. But what has changed since that experience? What has changed in your mind and in your heart and in the way that you live? What makes your profession of Christ being your Savior, what makes it something different, or what makes it something special from the religious world? How has that decision, or your confession, or your profession of Christ, how does that differ from the world? Hopefully you've gone through a conversion in your heart, right? Hopefully it's been changed. Hopefully you've said, goodbye to the old, hello to the new. Hopefully you are walking in that newness of life. But unfortunately, in today's world, it's getting harder and harder to tell the church apart from the world. Right? The church is becoming too much like the world, where we are supposed to be influenced the world. The world is influencing the church. Right? We're not trying to redefine what it is to be a Christian in this world today. That's not what we're out to do. Right, we're not trying to give Christianity a whole new definition. We're not supposed to lower our standards so that the world can fit into the church. Right, you are to be a reflection. You and I, we are to be a reflection of who Christ is. Romans 12, verse 1. Bible says, I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable to God, which is your reasonable service, and do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. So if you look at Christianity today and you compare it to the Christianity in its younger years, you'll see a big difference, right? You would see some very evident differences in the way that people lived. If we look at the church today and we compare it to the first century church, it's completely different, completely transformed. Right, in today's church, you'll have quote-unquote Christians who are Christians, but only in certain areas of their life they're Christian. Not every area of those quote-unquote Christians has been converted to Christ. Right, they still kind of have one foot in the world and one foot in the church, and they want the best of both worlds. They're not wholeheartedly surrendered to Jesus. And I think that should be our goal. Right, our goal should be, God, what can I do today to surrender more of my heart to you? What can I do today? What can I change today to be able to give you more of my heart, to be able to give you more of my life, where I can be more surrendered to you? What is it that I'm holding back? It could be that they've have not sanctified their habits, haven't sanctified their heart, haven't sanctified their mind, because that tells us a lot, right? When a person has sanctified these things or those areas in life, there is a difference in the way that people live. The sanctification is you're setting yourself apart. You're consecrating your life for the purpose of God rather than for the purpose of this world. And you're making a decision to say, God, I'm going to hold myself to a higher standard. I'm going to create those boundaries. I'm going to set those foundations. I'm going to walk in your way, and I'm going to keep my eyes on you, that I will not go back to the things of this world. So this would mean that there would be no loyalty to Christ as Savior from sin if people are not sanctifying their lives. There would be no loyalty to Christ. There would be no reason to be loyal to Christ. Why? Because they have not made a decision to be sanctified. So hopefully this evening you'll agree with me that there is something very distinctive about those who know Christ and those who don't know Christ. That hopefully you can tell the difference, or people can tell the difference in your life. You're not like the rest. You're not like them. There's something different about you. So what do you, a true believer, possess that is different from your non-believing neighbor? What do you possess that is different? What is it about you that differs from your neighbor who doesn't believe? What sets you apart? Maybe we can get a better understanding of the question if maybe we can answer it from the perspective of the first century church, right? So let's look at, secondly, at catching the love bug, or catch the love bug. Not the little car love bug, but the bug, the love bug. John chapter 13, verse 34 through verse 35. The Bible says, "A new commandment I give to you, that you love one another as I have loved you, that you also love one another. By this all will know that you are my disciples, if you have love for one another." Again, the text said that by this, right? He's honing in on something specific. And this, he says, "And by this shall all men know that you are my disciples." This, he's giving an emphasis on the word this, right? If what? Not if you belong to a certain denomination. Not if you have certain beliefs or pray and worship in a certain way. But he says, by this means that if you have love for one another, that's how you will know that they are disciples of Christ. See, love for one another, that's an easy thing to do, right? It's easy to get along with people. It's easy to love them. It's easy to befriend people, right? Love people. Right now, we're Valentine's, and you know, just give people gifts, and I love you, right? That's easy. You give maybe a few boxes of chocolates, maybe stuffed bear. Went to my wife's job today at the school, and they had a whole bunch of bags that kids couldn't give their boyfriend and girlfriend, so they left them there on the office desk. And people were trying to give gifts, right, to show my love for you. I love you $3.99 worth of love. I love you worth of a stuffed teddy bear that I probably found at the dollar store or something. That's how much I love you, right? But listen to what Matthew Henry, the commentary, says. They were to love each other for Christ's sake, and according to his example, seeking what might benefit others, and promoting the cause of the gospel as one body, animated by one soul. But this commandment still appears new to many professors. Men in general notice any of Christ's words rather than these. By this, it appears that if followers of Christ do not show love to one another, they give cause to suspect their sincerity. So in other words, if as believers, if we are not careful in sharing genuine love for one another, then people can suspect that our relationship with God is not genuine. Christians should stand out from non-believers, right? There should be a big difference. One of the ways that we should stand out above the rest, or above the rest of the world, is by the love that permeates from our hearts and our lives. Now, does this mean that we're going to gush in love for everyone in the world? Does this mean that we should send flowers to everyone that we can think of? Does this mean we should write cards and saying to people, I love you all the time? That's not what I'm saying, and that's not what the Bible is saying. Right? Loving one another was a new responsibility that Jesus was dumping on his followers. Loving one another was a new responsibility that Jesus had dropped on his disciples. And this was an essential commandment if they were going to be representing Christ. That this was a must. You must love each other. If you are going to represent my name, if you're going to say that you follow me, if you say that you're going to be a disciple, there must be love among you for each other. They could not go and make disciples of all nations unless they loved the lost, unless they loved the sinner, unless they loved the unlovely, right? It would be difficult. I try to imagine, you know, if we went to Modesto, if when we came here, if we didn't love people, how difficult would it be to establish a church? How difficult would it be to be able to take over a church if you were not loving people? We would destroy it rather than build it. Right? So in order for them to go and make disciples of all nations, they had to learn to love people. You want to make a difference. You want to make an impact. You've got to learn to love people. Well, you know, you've got to learn to love the unlovely. Sometimes you have to force yourself to love people, right? You don't always want to love everybody. Sometimes, yeah. Right, but you have to, that's what Jesus says, you have to show that there is a difference in your commitment, in the way that you love people. Love makes you do things that you otherwise would not do under different circumstances. Right? Love makes people do some crazy things. You love people, you love something, you'll do whatever it takes. Love is the main platform of forgiveness. Why would you forgive someone? Because you love them. Why wouldn't you forgive someone? Because you don't love them. You're not willing to love them. Right? But this is what Jesus is saying. He's saying, listen, you want to love. If you say you love, then you've got to love the unlovely. Why? Because love is the main platform of forgiveness. Jesus teaches to first love God, then he teaches to love one another. See, if you don't love God, you won't be able to love each other. And this is why he says you need to learn to love God first. And sometimes, to be honest, we don't really know the definition of love until we know God. Then we will know what love is. When we understand what God has done for us and how he's done it and what he went through to be able to give us and show us that love, then we understand, okay, wow, that's what love is. Love is not a card. Love is not money. Love is not chocolates. Love is not flowers. We have to be able to express Christ's likeness in order to reflect true, genuine love. Matthew 22, verse 34 through verse 39. But when the Pharisees heard that he had silenced the Sadducees, they gathered together. Then one of them, a lawyer, asked him a question, testing him and saying, "Teacher, which is the great commandment in the law?" Jesus said to him, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. This is the first and great commandment, and the second is like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself." So these are not necessarily two separate commandments. These go hand in hand with each other. Love God, and because you love God, you are also to love your neighbor, which we know is going to open a door to a whole different kind of people. Right? It's not just going to be the person next door, that neighbor. It's easy to probably love that neighbor. Maybe. Right? But to love your neighbor now opens the door to a whole different people that you are to love. And who is my neighbor? And then Jesus went on to give the parable of the Good Samaritan, right? See, you can pretend to be a person of love. Right? Yes. I love everyone. But see, that love will be tested sooner or later. If your love for all people is not genuine, eventually you're going to show your true colors. Right? Eventually, the reality of your quote-unquote love for them is going to come to the surface. Jesus said in our text the following. He said, "Love your enemies." How many do we love all of our enemies? We have a hard time, right? We can maybe put our hand like halfway up. Right? But loving our enemies, that's a challenge. But this is what Jesus said. He says, love your enemies. He's not giving you a choice. He's not saying, well, you know, if you're having a good day, love your enemies. But only if you want to. No, he says, love your enemies. Then he says, bless those who curse you. That's the last thing I want to do. I want to bless them with a knuckle sandwich. Then he goes on to say, he says, do good to those who hate you. Why am I going to do good to those that hate me? I'm going to hate them back. And more. Then he says, pray for those who spitefully use you and persecute you. So he's like digging in, man. He's like peeling away the tape that's on your scar, you know, on your cuts. And he's just tearing those things apart. And he's just opening up those wounds, man. He's opening up those offended areas in your life, and he's bringing some pain, right? He's making us cringe. These are hard to do. But listen, if you're professing to be a Christian, this is something that you must learn to do. See, God is kind. to unthankful, evil people. He loves us. Right? You were wicked. You were sinful. You were against and opposed God. But he still loved you. Still showed kindness to you. And this is why you must be merciful. Just as your Father is merciful. We have to be a reflection of who God is. Someone said the Christian of the first century outloved his pagan neighbor. The Christian of the first century outloved his pagan neighbor. Listen, that speaks volumes. When's the last time you tried to outlove someone who didn't love you? When's the last time you try to outdo an evil person in showing them love and respect, grace and mercy? But that's what the first century church did. See, these disciples, these followers of Christ, they learned to love hard. Whatever chasm or whatever division existed in God's people of the first century church, this was bridged through their Christianity. Whatever gap there was between believers, Jesus Christ came and built the bridge, and they were willing to help build that bridge between them and those that offended them. This was Christ-like behavior. Someone else said these early Christians were possessed of an eager interest in every human soul. They not only loved one another, but they loved strangers and outsiders. They loved strangers and outsiders. See, I've learned to love the enemies that I've had in the past. It's easier now to love them because it's things of the past. It happened a long ago, right? The wounds happened a long time ago, and so there's areas in my life that I've been able to be healed, but this wasn't something that the world taught me to do. If not for the love of God, if not for the convictions of the Holy Spirit, this would not be something any man would in the world would do. Their first goal would not be to forgive their enemies. If not for convictions, if not for the Holy Spirit, if not for the kindness of God, in our reality, in our flesh and our sinfulness, we would not want to forgive those that offended us. We want revenge. We want payback. Well, I was raised to be kind. Yeah, that because somebody taught you the right way, but left to yourself, you would think otherwise. Man left to himself would not even have a speck of desire to want to love their enemies. But this is the kind of love that Jesus taught. This is the kind of love that Jesus lived out. Right? We can see this love reflecting as he hung on the cross. Right? That's the ultimate reflection of love. Luke 23, verse 33 and 34. The Bible says, and when they had come to the place called Calvary, there they crucified him and the criminals, one on the right hand and the other on the left. Then Jesus said, Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they do. Now you might say, well, of course Jesus can do that. He's the Son of God. Of course he can forgive. But listen, he wasn't the only one who's recorded saying those words. Someone more, I don't want to say more human than Jesus, but someone less divine than Jesus said these words in Acts 7, verse 59 through 60. And they stoned Stephen as he was calling on God and saying, Lord Jesus, receive my spirit. Then he knelt down and cried out with a loud voice, Lord, do not charge them with this sin. And when he had said this, he fell asleep. Here's a disciple, a follower of Jesus, asking for the sins of the enemy, those that are throwing rocks at him, for their sins not to be counted against them. I mean, who in their right mind or in their Christian right mind would do that? Someone who learned love. You know, I try to put myself in his shoes. What would I say? What would I have said? I've been hit in the head with rocks before, and I can tell you, it wasn't those words that came out of my mouth. But what would we say if that was us? In the current condition that we are in right now, what words would come out of our mouth if that's what happened to us right now? So this is what I mean about the first century church loving hard. Right? It was difficult to dismiss or overlook the presence of a genuine follower of Christ. You knew who was following Christ and you knew who wasn't. Their love for people was able to shine through, and this is how we should be willing to love people in the 21st century. So let's look at, finally, at pay the price. Because if you're going to love people, regardless of how they are with you, there's going to be a price you have to pay. When the group of 120 followers, when they gathered together in the upper room, they were there to pray. They were there to lay a hold of God. They were there waiting for the promise. Right? And as they sat there praying, contending for the promise, the Bible tells us that they were filled with the Holy Spirit and they spoke in other tongues and they were speaking of the wonderful works of God. That's what the Bible tells us. Look at what it says in Acts 2, verse 11 through 13. It says, Cretans and Arabs, we hear them speaking in our own tongues the wonderful works of God. So they were all amazed and perplexed, saying to one another, whatever should this mean? Or whatever could this mean? Others mocking said, they are full of new wine. In other words, they are drunk. Now, here we have a group that became intoxicated. But they weren't intoxicated with wine. They became intoxicated with the Holy Spirit. They became intoxicated with the power of God. The power of God just rained on them. It fell on them. The Bible says it was like tongues of fire. Right? Something was there. Something was consuming their flesh. Something was giving them power. Something was giving them authority. And they were driven by this and they were intoxicated. This was the beginning of a powerful move of God through the church body. This was a Holy Ghost intoxication that set their hearts on fire. Something happened on that day. These people were not the same anymore. They had an experience. Their hearts were regenerated. Their minds were transformed. Their wills were broken. And something happened within them. The church was never the same after this. Within this intoxication, guess what? They didn't wake up the next morning with a hangover. They just experienced a powerful move of God. And so the Bible says that many were added daily to the church because of what happened. The church grew. Church spread. These were people that didn't only follow Christ. They went out and made disciples. They went out and multiplied in disciple making. They wanted to win the world, right? But it came with a cost that they were willing to pay the price for. They said, we're willing to pay this price. This was not a cheap camping trip. This wasn't, a weekend journey. This wasn't, a three-day drive for them. This is something that they had to really sacrifice in. This cost them their lives. Right? They knew what it would take to be committed to the end. They knew. Because a lot of them knew what Jesus had done. A lot of them knew that he went to the cross. A lot of them knew that he laid down his life. And they were saying, you know what? We're willing. But it didn't matter because they became followers of Jesus. Right? They knew there was a hefty price tag on that ministry. On whatever it was that they took up, they understood there was a price tag behind it. They may not have understood the full scale of the cost, but they understood that for Jesus, it cost his life on that cross. And if Jesus is willing to die for people, and if he's willing to forgive people, then you know what? We're willing to do whatever it takes. We're willing to pay the cost. That's what the first century church said. Their love for Jesus was greater than anything that they ever loved. Because they were willing to forsake it all for him. Right? And so at least this is what Jesus taught. He was clear and there was no fine print. He made it clear to those that would follow what it was going to cost them, right? Matthew chapter 16, verse 24, as I begin to wrap this up. Matthew 16, 24 through 27 says, then Jesus said to his disciples, if anyone desires to come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. For whoever desires to save his life will lose it, but whoever loses his life for my sake will find it. For what profit is it to a man if he gains the whole world and loses his own soul? Or what will man give in exchange for his soul? For the Son of Man will come in the glory of his Father with his angels, and then he will reward each according to his works. Listen, the first century church was willing to pay the price for the reward in following Christ. There's a reward. You want to follow Christ, there's a reward, but there's also a price. There was a world out there that's waiting for you and I to go and make disciples. There is a world out there waiting for you, waiting for me, waiting for us to take the gospel to it. But we all have to make a choice. Will we love God enough to go? Will we love God enough? Will you love the lost souls enough to pay the price of dying to self? See, dying to self is not an easy thing. Dying to self is filled with pain. It hurts to die to self. Hopefully you don't expect to be obedient to God without dying to self, because dying to self is part of you being obedient to God. And so there's only so much distance that you will go without dying to yourself. Someone said there simply is no cheap and easy way to be a Christian. I like that. There is no shortcuts. There is no, going through tunnels and different pipes like Mario, right? Going through one world to another just by going in through. There's no shortcuts. There's no easy way to be a Christian. The first century church was willing to face danger. Was willing to face death rather than to be disloyal to their Savior. They were stoned. They were sawn in half. They were tempted, killed with the sword. They wandered about in sheepskin and goatskins, being destitute, afflicted, tormented. Listen, church, they paid the price. They wandered in deserts and in mountains and in dens and caves of the earth. The first century church left us an example to follow. But will you dare to walk the same difficult road? Will the 21st century church, will that church be willing to pay the price? If you have genuine love for God and souls, then you'll agree that our eternal reward is worth living for God, regardless of what you're going to face on this side of eternity. Our reward is much greater. But you have to be willing to love and love hard. And so the question is what will you do more than others? What is it about you? What is it about the way you live that distinguishes you from others? If there's not much, then maybe you need to check your heart and die to self more. Right? But what will you do more than others? Let's bow our heads. Let's close our eyes for just a few moments. Every head bowed and every eye closed. Each of us are called to make a decision for ourselves. Each of us are called to make a decision in such a way that it's going to cause us to consider what are we willing to give up? What are we willing to lay down? What are you willing to do to show your love for God? And maybe this evening your sins have separated you from the love of God. You haven't surrendered your life to Jesus. You haven't given your life to Jesus. You haven't made a decision to die to self. You're still living in your sin. But tonight I want to challenge you to give your life to Jesus. To make a decision to be different from the world. Make a decision that's going to cause you to lay down your life. Whatever God wants you to do. And maybe here tonight you want salvation, you want to make that decision to commit your life to Him for the first time, or you want to get your heart right, you want to get things right in your own heart. You say, yes, Pastor, I want to pray and I want to surrender my life to Jesus. Right where you're sitting, would you lift up your hand? We want to pray with you. Anyone tonight, you want to give your life or you want to recommit your life to Him? Lift up your hand. Anyone tonight? Amen. As every head is bowed and every eye is closed, ask yourself that question. What makes me different from those in the world? Or what sets me apart from my ungodly friends, from my ungodly family members? What is the distinguishing factor? Can people really tell that I love Jesus? The way that I'm committed, does that reflect my genuine love for Christ? Does my faithfulness reflect Christ-likeness? Do my decisions reflect the mind of Christ? Do the words that I speak, are those words that Jesus would speak? Words of forgiveness, words of kindness. What do you do more than others? What does your life reflect? Let's consider this question. We're going to open up these altars. You want to come, find a place to pray. You want to come and allow the Holy Spirit to come and search your heart. Let God shine some light to the condition of your heart, to your commitment, to your faithfulness, to your stability, to the way that you live. And maybe there are some things that you do need to work out. Bring them to the altar tonight. Let's work these issues out. You come, find a place to pray. Come cry out to God. We're going to sing a song as we open it up.
With all my
worship him tonight. Oh, Father, we worship you, Lord. We exalt your holy name, God. You move upon your people, God. Let us
Baba si kolo bobo bo sendere bebe be sata la baba sendere bebe sende. Raba baba si tolo bo si kalaba sendere be sende. O raba baba si talabo se kere be sata la bo se. O robo bo si tolo bo sendere be se.
Let's give him praise tonight.
Oh,
amen, amen. What do you do more than others? Listen, we have to learn to sanctify our lives daily. Something we have to do is die to self every day. Let's be different. This is how we are going to be more than conquerors in 2024. It's by laying it all down. Let's be willing. Let's press forward. Let's endure. Let's pay the price. Amen. We're going to be dismissed. Keep in mind the announcements, marriage retreat, couples fellowship. If you have any questions, let me know. Please take some flyers with you. Tell someone about Jesus. Interrupt someone's day and tell them about the love of God. Tell them what God's done in your life. Because they can't say that's a lie. Because it's from your experience. So you go with that. Stick around. Fellowship with one another. Let's bow our heads. Let's close our eyes. Stefan, would you pray? Dismiss us tonight.